Hi there. I'd like to say welcome to the TCA Museum and thank the TCA staff and everybody here for bringing us in and allowing us to talk to you as we do every spring and fall. And it's really it's a privilege to follow the Strasburg guys, the railroad. It's one of the things that I like the most about coming here. Obviously, I like the show. I like trains, or I wouldn't have all this nonsense in front of me. But I love the Strasburg Railroad. My father brought me there from the time I was 4 or 5 years old until he passed away a few years ago. We've come. It's more of a museum than just a train ride. It's history. My grandfather was an engineer on the Pennsylvania Railroad on the Terminal Division in Philadelphia. And it's a pleasure to go there, see the equipment, ride the trains, and it's nice to see the younger generations going there. So if you get a chance, if you haven't, I'm assuming most of you guys have already been there or over the years have gone, but if you haven't been to the railroad around the corner, please go and check it out and take a ride. It's really, really worth the effort. Being a history guy, I love it. So be that as it may, I'm here from Bachmann Industries in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We're right down the street, an hour or two down the road. And I've brought a lot of product here to show you today. We have a catalog out this year, and I'll just briefly discuss the piece on the front of the catalog. The piece on the front of the catalog is the Amtrak Siemens ACS-64 locomotive. And to my knowledge, I think there may be an N-scale version of this out there by another manufacturer, but we're one of the first mainstream manufacturers to do this locomotive. And we've done it in HO scale. That's what's on the front here. And I have a production sample here. And you'll see it doesn't have any markings on it yet because we are still undergoing back and forth on the markings and the paint schemes and things. It's just about done. All the artwork's just about finished. So if you want to come by our booth and take a look at the ACS-64, this is a really, really sharp locomotive. It's pretty. It's sleek. All the young guys know this locomotive, so we're hoping that it does very well. It goes very nicely with Amfleet cars. I watch them going back and forth on the Northeast Corridor right behind where I work every day. So that's the ACS-64. Okay, I think what I'll do is I'll start with the smaller scale. Bachmann does all scales, and I'm sure every year I ask how many O-scale guys are out here in N-scale and HO, and the majority of you are O-scale. So you all have to put up with me for a little while until we get to MTH and Lionel and all that. But I grew up, and it's funny because as the generations go by, you know, the older guys grew up with O-scale. I grew up with HO. When I was young, my father set up our O-scale, our Lionel trains and so forth for us every year. And when I got to about 8 or 9 years old, he took me to the hobby store and we bought an HO set because that's what was coming into vogue at that point. He handed it to me and said, okay, ball's in your court now, you do it. So from that point on, it was HO. And now we're 45 years or so down the line, I'm starting to realize that HO is not really a new thing, neither is N scale. So it's just as much of a toy train or remembrance for people as the O scale trains that you're seeing. And if you go into the museum here, they have all the different scales. There's O scale, there's large scale, there's HO, there's N scale. So, you know, take a little time. I used to work for LGB trains, and I never gave a second thought to European trains until I worked there and I started to get a taste of it. And I got very interested and I got very into European trains for a while. So my point being, if you haven't done HO, you haven't done N or ON30, sometimes it's worth a look at something a little bit different than what you're used to, and it might open a new world to you. So come to our booth and look at all the different scales and so forth. So I'm going to move this up. And hopefully you can still hear me. I'm going to leave the microphone here. We're doing a few new pieces in N scale this year. And N scale is a great scale. I did this when I was young. As I've gotten older, I've had to get these guys out just to get them on the track. It's tough stuff to see sometimes, but the detail's incredible on these. And this is our new consolidation. This is a 280 consolidation. And what's special about this, we've had this out in the past, but this year we're bringing it out with DCC sound. And we're making strides, more and more strides in N-scale with sound. And believe it or not, it's really tough to get sound in an N-scale loco just because of the size of the tenders and things. It used to be you had to have a pencil eraser-sized speaker in these, which created no bass, no sound. But we've gotten better, and the speakers have gotten better, and the decoders have gotten smaller. So We're doing the N-scale consolidation. We have about four different road names. And if you excuse me, I'm going to cheat and get my little cheat sheet out here so I can tell you what they are. Okay. We're going to do Western Pacific, which is this guy right here. It's a really nice paint scheme with the Western Pacific logo. It's got the silver firebox and so forth, or smoke jacket. We're going to do Union Pacific, Norfolk and Western, New York Central, and Western Maryland in the consolidation. It's a beautiful little piece. These should be here anytime. The next piece that we're doing in N-scale is new tooling. And like they say, good things come in small packages. I could put a whole N-scale consist in this little tiny box here. And excuse me for not having unwrapped these, but I rolled in a little late here. This is our newest N-scale locomotive. I didn't even take the foam out of it. I'm just going to pop this out real quick. I don't want to break the railings. Yeah, I'm going to hold it up for you. I just wanted to get this foam out of here because it makes it... There we go. Bear with me here. Okay. This is our newest piece of tooling in N-scale, and this is an SD9. The SD9, you know, standard freight engine, very similar to some of the other things we've done, like the Jeeps, Jeep 7s and 9s and so forth. And I don't have the listing here of road names, but I have a Norfolk and Western. I believe we're doing Burlington, Union Pacific, a couple other road names. And this is another piece where we've done DCC sound. And it's a really, really nice piece. We've done a sound value decoder. Our company, our OEM Soundtracks in Durango, Colorado, does our soundboards. A very nice little piece, has really strong sound. If you come by the booth, I'll try and get some track out, put these on them so you can hear them. But I get just as good a sound out of these as I do my HO locomotives now. So if you're interested in N-scale and you like diesels, this is brand new. I don't think I've seen an SD9 tooled for a long time in N-scale. So this is a really nice piece. So that's my second N-scale piece. And we have one other piece that we're re-releasing in N-scale. And we've upgraded the mechanics in it. We've upgraded the drivetrain. And it's a Dash 8 CW. And this one also will have sound. And various road names, so it's DCC sound. So I've got the SD9, I've got the Dash 8, and the consolidation. They're my three newest N-scale pieces. And I also have another piece in a small box. I have a new freight car in N-scale. And what I have here is a little tiny ore car. And we've done this piece in HO. I have an ore car in O-scale, and I'll hold them up together so you can just get an idea of the size difference between O and N-scale. I mean, this thing would disappear into here. But we're doing the ore cars in various road names. I have Union Pacific here. I believe we're doing DM and IR, Union Pacific, and I believe Pennsylvania in the ore cars. So come on over and have a look at these guys. They go really nicely with the SD9. And I'll put this away. Okay, so the next thing I'd like to talk about is HO, a little bit on HO. HO is our strongest line. We do more HO than we do anything else. Why that is, I don't know, but it's a very strong scale, and it's our lion's share. It's what we do the most of. So one thing that I brought along that I wanted to show that I don't think gets a lot of attention are our 19th century. They call them old time. I don't like to call them old time. They're 19th century cars and locomotives. We took our 440 American locomotive and we retooled it about 2 years ago, 3 years ago, and we improved the drivetrain. It used to have a little electric motor in the tender that had a drive rod that went into the boiler. We eliminated that. We put the motor into the boiler since the motors have gotten smaller. Electric motors are much smaller now than they used to be. So we had room to put the motor into the boiler and mount a DCC sound decoder and speaker into the tender. And we've done various versions of the 440, the Rogers locomotive. We've done the obvious UPCP Golden Spike locomotives, the 119 and the Jupiter. We've done the General. This is the Texas, which kind of goes with the General, and various other road names. But the reason I bring these out is that they're very popular. 440s and 19th century equipment holds a mystique, or, you know, people associate railroading with these locomotives, and they sell really well, and I think it's for that reason. People just see it, and it just screams Americana. And what we've done is we've upgraded some of our older coaches and passenger cars. We've redone the roofs. We've redone some of the equipment on them. I brought Pennsylvania cars for obvious reasons. We're in Pennsylvania, and it's my favorite road name. But we've done a new baggage car. We redid our combine and our coach. And then we've done a series of freight cars. And this is kind of an ongoing series, and I'm really enjoying this because these are cars you don't see that often. And they're smaller cars. They're usually like 20 foot or so size-wise. And we did a brand new tank car. You can see this is a U.S. Military Railroad tank car. It's a 19th century car. We've redone some tooling on these cars, which is a derrick car and a blacksmith car, which has some really nice detail on them. You can see they've got, you know, little accessory details on there. We've done a series of box cars to go with them in different road names. This one's a Pennsylvania Lines. We've done various road names, and we've done a bobber caboose, which is this guy here. And I just threw them all out here just so you could see them. And like I say, if you're interested in HO or if you're interested in 19th century, this is a really strong locomotive. We really did a lot of work on this to get it up to current standards mechanically. So that's my 18th century spiel. And I really like these cars. If you go up, I believe, you know, we got our paint information from the Railroad Museum around the corner, the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania. So you can go up and take a look at one of these passenger cars sitting up in the museum. Okay, so that's my 19th century cars. We're also doing a Jeep 30 in HO with DCC and sound, and I brought a couple samples, and I brought this box just to show you guys. This is our sound value box. It's a red box, and it's a DCC sound locomotive. We basically have taken one of our older locomotives and revamped it, improved the mechanics inside the drivetrain, and we've added a DCC sound decoder. It's in our sound value line, so it's a little less expensive. The DCC sound chip is integrated into the circuit board, the printed circuit board, so it brings the price down a little bit. I brought a Pennsylvania. I brought a B&O. We're doing Southern Pacific, Union Pacific, and there's one other that you can come by the booth and look at that right off the top of my head. Oh, it's right on the front here. Santa Fe. So UP, Santa Fe, Southern Pacific, Pennsylvania, and B&O. And Pennsylvania is the nicest one. Anything with a Keystone. Love it. Okay. Another new piece, two new pieces in HO that we're kind of excited about. And this is something that, and I have to find my little package here. This is something I'm surprised hasn't been done before. I think it's been done before in like a cottage industry type product, but not in a mainstream commercially manufactured vein. We're doing a Fred. I don't know if you guys know what Fred is. Most of you do, I'm sure, guys, the railroad guys out here. Fred's an end-of-train device. In other words, when the railroads kind of abandoned their cabooses, they went to a flashing end-of-train device on the end of the train. Right here, this little yellow box right here has a flashing LED in it. We've done, and I'm going to open the book again. Pardon me for cheating. We've done five different road names in this boxcar. It's a 50-foot outside-braced boxcar. This is the CSX version. We've done Railbox, Canadian National, Burlington Northern, and Greenville and Northern Railway with these. And we've also done a separate truck with the Fred on it. So if you guys have different freight cars and you want to add the end-of-train device, you can buy this truck separately, and it has a little circuit board mounted on the truck, and then the Fred is mounted on the coupler. So you just drop your old truck off, pop this guy on, and the electricity from the track drives it. It's a really cool little piece. It flashes, it's really bright, you can't miss it. So if you've got modern freight and you wanna get rid of that unprototypical caboose at the end, there's your device. So Fred's really cool, we like Fred. All right, and another piece that we're doing in HO right now is a new bay window caboose. So we did Fred, now we're going backwards, back to caboose. We're doing these, and they're modular in the manufacturing approach. In other words, we've done a bay window caboose that we can do on different road names by changing out the side windows and some of the detail work on it. So we've done a New York Central, a nickel plate, Erie, Union Pacific, and a B&O version. And if you grab a sheet up here, I've got catalogs and some of these new product sheets up here. After I'm done, you can come up and grab one. You can take a look at these bay window caboose in the catalog, and you'll see what I'm talking about by the difference in the side windows. But this is a neat little piece. These are on the way. These should be here anytime if you do HO. It's a great little piece. Okay, HO, let me see what else I got. I think that's it for HO. Oh no, well, I got something else, but it kind of goes into O gauge, so we'll do it at the same time. So what you've all waited for, O-gauge. I'm going to tease you a little bit and do narrow gauge first. I'm going to do ON30, talk about ON30 a little bit. ON30, I talk about this every time I come here, and I talk about it at the show. ON30 is narrow gauge. In other words, it's ON30, which means O scale, N is narrow gauge, 30 is the track width, 30-inch track width. So narrow gauge are, I left all the foam in on my thing. Narrow gauge are prototypes that are 1/48 scale. So if you look at a person next to the train, it works out to 1/48 scale. But it's narrow gauge, which means the trucks are narrow for tighter turns and moving around in like industrial areas, things like that. It's lighter equipment that's used in logging, mining, and applications, industrial applications. So it runs on, it's an O-scale train, but it runs on HO track. Sounds weird, but it works. It's a narrow gauge track, so our HO track works really well with it, and you can run O-gauge trains on HO track. Sounds strange, but it's what it looks like in the real world. If you go out and look at a narrow gauge railroad, the tracks are a lot more narrow. So what we did this year, we did a couple of new freight cars to go with our ON30 line. We've done in the past a lot of locomotives, a lot of ON30 locos. And in freight cars, we did standard 40-foot box cars and gondolas and reefers and all that. And we decided to do shorter cars, little shorty 18-foot cars. So we did box cars, gons, various other cars in ON30, 18-foot cars, and people kept asking us, when are we going to get a caboose? When are we going to get a caboose? So we finally got the caboose in. The caboose, it's like caboose day here. Got a lot of caboose stuff. We did two different versions of the ON30 18-foot caboose. We did a logging caboose, which means it's just a flat top with no cupola, and then we did a little 18-footer with a cupola on top. And we did various road names, White Pass, Durango, and Silverton. ON30 modelers don't like road names. They want to do their own thing. And it only makes sense because most narrow gauge railroads were private companies. They weren't usually run by railroads. In other words, you wouldn't see Union Pacific, Southern Pacific, so forth. The White Pass was a dedicated narrow gauge line, from what I understand. Same with Durango and Silverton. They were narrow gauge lines, so we put those on them. But the other caboose we did MOW colors. We did yellow, we did red, we did gray. MOWs with just markings on them. In other words, stenciling or data marks. So those are my ON30 narrow gauge caboose. Is caboose. I'm hoping caboose is the plural of caboose because I keep saying it. I'm not sure. And we also did a derrick car, which I think is really cool, and it's something people have been asking for a long time. They wanted a breakdown train. So we've already done flat cars, which go with this. It's kind of like the deal up here. So we did a nice derrick car to go with our ON30 line. This is the Durango and Silverton version. You can see DNS on the side. And we've done about three or four other schemes, like I say, the MOW colors, and I believe we did a White Pass in this also, but I'm going to look at my paper here really quickly. We're doing White Pass and Yukon, MOW Oxide Red, Durango and Silverton, MOW Yellow, and MOW Gray. So if you have an O-scale layout and you're looking for something different to put in there, put in a mining operation, put in a logging operation. Logging is big with ON30 guys. They like the steam donkeys and they like, things that pull trees down the mountains, things like that. But you can fit a nice little narrow gauge loop into your O-gauge layout, and it adds a lot of interest because it's different. I mean, when people see it, they immediately are drawn to it because it's very different. So think about ON30 narrow gauge. It's neat stuff. It's O-gauge. Fun stuff. Okay. I also have O-scale. I have some new figures, which I liked. I'm a figure guy. I'm a hobbyist. I like model building. In other words, I like trains. Trains are fun. But to me, trains are the secondary thing. I like building buildings. I like doing landscaping. I like painting figures. I like sculpting figures. I like everything that goes into building the environment. And we just released some new figures. And we do a line of product called Scenescapes. Scenescapes is scenery products. It's pretty obvious from the name. We make trees. We make grass. We make static grass, which is the stuff you sprinkle and then run the static device over and it stands up. That's neat stuff. But we're releasing some new figures, and we're doing them in HO and O. The HO figures just came in. The O-scale guys are on the way. I'm going to show you the packaging here. They're in a nice blister cart. And these are my horses. I have 6 horses and a bale of hay in this package. And I'll show you, these are the O-scale versions of the horses. So I have HO and I have O-scale and Scenescapes figures. And these are really cool. These are neat horses in the respect that you've got some things here that you don't normally see. Usually you just see standing horses or a running horse. This is nice because you get a little foal, you get a little horse. You get a horse with a blanket on it, which I think is really neat. And you get a horse that's laying down on its side. So these break things up a little bit. You got one with a saddle, one without. So take a look at our horses and our figures. I'm going to show you the other figures also. So that's the horses. These guys here are called civil engineers. These are your road guys. These are your guys out on the road crew fixing things, digging holes. A couple guys just standing around there, the supervisors. So these are the HO versions in a little blister card. And then these are my O-scale versions here. And I brought the O-scale versions because they're so much easier to see so that my camera guy can get in on them and take a look at them. So that's civil engineers. I have, these are really neat too. This is something people ask for a lot. And we have seated passengers in HO and O. So you can see they're missing their legs, so they can fit in your passenger cars. So you can pop the roof off your O-scale passenger car and populate it. And they all come pre-painted, which is nice. You know, I've seen them before in an unpainted version. And I sat down and painted figures for a couple of, I did 3 cars one night. Well, one night, 1 week. It took about a week to paint all the figures and get them in the cars. So it's nice to get them pre-painted. I have HO, O-scale, seated passengers. And I have these guys here. These guys create a lot of attention. I don't know why. They're pigs. Everybody likes the pigs. I guess they all go to the Wyeth Museum, the Chatsford Museum, and see the big painting of the pig. Everybody likes pigs. So I went ahead, and when I painted the samples for these, I did different types of pigs. I didn't want to give everybody just a box of pink pigs, you know, flesh-colored pigs. So I did brown guys with brown and, I guess you'd call it flesh color, and then black with flesh, and then the little, you got a little tiny pig in there too. So I've got HO pigs and O-scale pigs. So come and take a look at the piggies. And last but not least, I have what they call street people. And I don't mean street people. They're called sidewalk people. So these are folks that you would find in your city scenes. Some people walking around, a little guy that looks like a census taker, little lady with an apron on, and then a little lady here that's kind of scrubbing down the steps. So come and take a look at the sidewalk people as well, HO and O scale. So the figures are neat. I like the figures. They come pre-painted. They're just really well detailed. Come and have a look. You've got to have people on your layout. And one of the things I've always noticed that drives me crazy is people don't take a lot of time with their figures and things. In other words, they spend a lot of time on track work, spend a lot of time on buildings, on scenery, and then they plop a figure down that looks horrible. And especially like magazines, I've always noticed like Model Railroader, you look at the cover and there's this beautiful train, it's beautiful scenery, and then there's a figure standing there with a big giant seam line running down its head and the paint's all off and it just throws everything off. So get some nice figures, put some nice figures on your layout. It really does make a difference. Okay, O-scale. Have a couple pieces here from Williams, and this is something that was announced previously, and they're just coming in the door at work. I think in a couple weeks they should be coming in to the back warehouse. These are our F-59PH locomotives. F-59 is an Amtrak locomotive, passenger service locomotive. We've done 3 different schemes, and I don't want to use the wrong names on them. This one's a Cascades locomotive, California Cascades. Really pretty paint scheme. These feature TrueBlast Plus, which is our digital soundboard. TrueBlast Plus is a big improvement over the old TrueBlast that used to be in the old Williams products. It is digitally recorded at Soundtracks in Durango, Colorado. It's recorded from the actual trains, and it is a digital sound. And it's not reliant on any digital signals. In other words, you don't have to have digital control to use digital sound in this locomotive. And it's a plug-in type system. We've done separate sailboards with TrueBlast Plus that you can buy that retrofit your old Williams locos just by pulling the plug and plugging in the new one. So this is the Amtrak Cascades. This is the one you probably see the most of. These pull the surfliners in California. This is the Amtrak Pacific Surfliner. Pretty locomotive, great paint scheme. Same thing, it has TrueBlast Plus digital sound. And last but not least, this one's called Amtrak California, for obvious reasons. I've seen these guys. These run pretty much, you know, standard urban, interurban type, you know, passenger service. So this is pretty, too. Nice dark blue scheme. Same thing, True Blast Plus. And the other O-scale piece I brought were our new ore cars. And I brought the ore cars because I thought it was neat to show them next to the little N-scale ore car. New cars, it's all new tooling. Great stuff. This is BNLE, Milwaukee Road, DM&IR, Dasabi, Duluth Misabi, and Iron Range. Takes a second sometimes. And CP Rail. So these are all new. Come and have a look at them at our booth. And the other thing that we're working on, and I don't have a sample yet, I had drawings, but I didn't want to bring drawings. I don't like doing that. We're doing a new 70-ton diesel in Williams. We've done this. We've done this in N scale. We've done it in HO, and now we're translating up to O scale with it. And we're doing four schemes: Southern Pacific, Canadian National, Tropicana, which is my favorite. I think that's really neat, and Rutland. So these should be out hopefully beginning of the year. We're working on it now, doing the drawing work and so forth, and probably start cutting tools real soon. So that's basically what I have. I would like to pontificate for 1 minute just about the hobby in general. And I say this a lot, and I've said it here before. I'm a hobby guy, like I said earlier, and I like to go to hobby stores, and I like to talk to people that do it, and I like to see what people are doing. And it's getting harder and harder and harder to do that. And for obvious reasons, e-commerce has had an effect on stores that are out there. I just want to encourage you guys to think about it when you go to buy something. Think about if you've got a local retailer near you. If he's a nice guy, a reasonable guy, give him some business. It's really important. And I don't say that as a manufacturer. I say that as a hobbyist. Support your hobby. Also, share your hobby. Go out and talk to people about it. Share it with your nieces, nephews, grandchildren, whatever. Get people interested. My kids, I encourage them, and they do a little bit, but they're older now, college age and so forth. But if we don't share this, it's not going to be around forever. People think that if you just keep throwing new product out there, it's going to continue. It doesn't. If there's no one out there to buy my product, I can't make it. I can't pay for the tooling to do all these new things. And that's why you're seeing a little bit of a slimline sometimes with manufacturers now, because they have to keep selling the old stuff. And to sell the old stuff, you got to have new customers. And that gets you new product. So think about it. If you know people, if you can encourage people, just share the hobby. I mean, it's really, my dad shared it with me, and that's why I'm standing here. Share it with people you know and enjoy it. But support your local guys. It's really important. If anybody has any questions, I'll take them. Otherwise, come see us in the Orange Hall. We're in the back, you know, where all the manufacturers are. I have catalogs here. Please come and help yourself. Grab a new product sheet. And like I say, come on up. I'll be happy to answer any questions you have. And thank you for your time.